This August marks 25 years since Hurricane Andrew tore through South Florida, making landfall in Homestead and leaving behind a path of destruction that most Floridians had never seen before. It was also when we got to know WTVJ Chief Meteorologist Bryan Norcross very well, as he stayed on the air for 23 hours, talking frightened residents through the storm, the only connection that many had to the outside world. Now, Norcross has teamed up with History Miami Museum as a guest curator for their latest exhibit focusing on the impact and the lessons learned from Andrew.
The wee hours of August 24, 1992 are unforgettable for those South Floridians who lived through the fateful and frightening night when Hurricane Andrew roared ashore. The Category 5 storm made landfall in Homestead. With 165-mile-an-hour sustained winds, homes and buildings were torn apart, rooftops ripped off, and landscapes flattened. Andrew's devastating path of destruction killed 65 people, left another 350,000 homeless, and caused $26.5 billion in damages. With power out and antennas down, it was the calming voice of then WTVJ Chief Meteorologist Bryan Norcross who helped residents weather the storm. Listening to his clear voice during his now famous 23-hour marathon broadcast. Norcross, now senior hurricane specialist for the Weather Channel, is guest curator of History Miami's latest exhibit, Hurricane Andrew, 25 years later. The exhibit features plexiglass panels hung in the round shape of a hurricane that take us back in time, showing videos of Norcross's coverage and some of the devastating first images after the storm. It also includes first-person accounts from some of Miami-Dade residents who lived through the worst of Andrew, as well as historical footage, plus thank you letters Norcross received from residents grateful to him for helping them get through that terrifying night.
I've been carrying around four boxes of stuff, letters, a box that high of letters that people sent me, and poems and songs on cassettes that they performed after the storm, some of which I remember they played on the radio for a while. So I had that kind of stuff. I also had magazines, newspapers, all those sorts of things, and I don't know, it was four boxes worth of videos and everything. So I brought that and gave that to the folks here. They digitized them, they went through them, they found them, and many of them are here in the exhibit.
Take us back to the time that the storm was approaching. You're watching it on the radar, and you're seeing that this is going to become very significant and a big deal for South Florida.
Well, remember back to that time, we didn't get so excited so early, right? People didn't have a phone in their pocket to look at every 10 minutes to get themselves excited. And Andrew was not well developed. 4 days before the storm, the hurricane hunters were saying, we can't even find a circulation. And if they had followed protocol, they would actually have taken the name off of it and said, okay, we're stopping advisories, it's over for now, we'll see what happens. 3 days before, it still wasn't terribly organized, but I was a little bit nervous, and that Friday afternoon was the afternoon I was looking at the computer models when they came in, and I went to the news director running WTVJ's news at the time, Sharon Scott, and said, I think we should start talking about this, raise the flag, because it's Friday afternoon. It took until the next day before everybody else was in gear. And I have thought about this a lot. Why did I do it and other people didn't do it? And I really think it's because, first of all, I'd studied the hurricane problem for a couple years and I was really in my mind. But also, I was just conscious of the fact it was Friday. If it had been Thursday, I wouldn't have probably done it, because it was a low odds thing that it was going to be a threat that Friday. But because it was Friday and people were going to be tuned out over the weekend, I thought, this is too risky. And then by Sunday afternoon, it looked way beyond anything that I had imagined. And even imagining this incredible storm that we saw on the radar and what it would do, it was still worse.
Take us back to being in that bunker at WTVJ with your co-anchors, Kelly Craig and Tony Segreto at the time. What were the three of you experiencing?
We were really just doing it moment by moment. The way the bunker came about, that was one of the things that was not part of our plan, our hurricane plan. We had extensive hurricane plans at WTVJ, and we used essentially every backup system that we had put in place to stay on the air and to continue broadcasting. But the bunker came about because when the storm, when those red pixels showed up on the radar and I was aware that this was going to be as bad as any hurricane could be, and not that far from us, even though I was pretty sure it was going to be south, but not that far, I was looking in the studio up at the roof. And we were protected on all sides by lots of concrete walls, but not at the roof. And that roof had a lot of equipment on it, and it was an old building. The building was built in the 20s. And I got nervous about that roof. Yeah. And then I got thinking, you know, if we were to leave the studio, that would convince people that we were really serious about going to a safe spot. So it turned out that the studio manager was a guy named John Lugren. And the production manager, Bruce Carter, was there. And we had the whole management team was there through the whole storm. It wasn't just me and Tony and Kelly.
Yeah.
We were all there. Yeah. Right? And I said, can we set up some place where we can move off the set? And John had this storage room right off the studio. It was right opposite the news desk, actually.
Wow.
And they set it up in a matter of 20, 25 minutes or something like that. And then Kelly Craig was on the set with me at that time. And she started talking about what we were going to do. And then Tony went over into the bunker. And so at 3:30, we decided, okay, now's the time to go, because we wanted to give people enough time to get moved, because I could see that the worst of it was coming ashore. The first big thing we saw on the radar was we saw the radar fail. It gusted up to 147 miles per hour, and the radar gave up, and it fell off as a big multi-ton radar, crashed onto the roof of this high-rise building, shook the entire
wow.
building to its core.
Though advances in technology have transformed weather forecasting by leaps and bounds since Andrew, Bryan says the same technology can also be a hindrance during a modern-day disaster.
On the technology side, back then, everybody had a transistor radio, and many people, surprised me, had a transistor television. A little battery-operated television. We're able to watch when they're in their closets. They actually had these little
black and white,
black and white TVs, right? Back in the days of analog television, which we don't have anymore,
right?
Either we have digital television now. So we have all this digital communications now, from our cell phones to the internet to television. None of it is as robust as a transistor radio and a real landline phone that was connected by those two wires, not over the cable, not over the fiber, but just over a wire that went back to the phone company. And most people don't have either transistor radios or landline phones now. So that's a huge public safety problem.
Norcross says there are big lessons that have been learned from Andrew. Because of where we live, we can never become complacent.
People are looking for ways to convince themselves that, you know, it's going to be okay. And which is fine up to a point, right? Well,
yeah.
What we want is, we don't want people getting too nervous too soon, right? But when the time comes and they have a window of preparation, then they have to prepare. Hurricane Andrew, in that time, in 1992, a day was enough time.
Yeah.
You know, we had Sunday. We had all day Sunday. And people did what they think they needed to do. Now, if they had to do again, knowing what was going to happen, they would have done a lot more.
Right.
And many, many more people would have left, and the traffic on the turnpike and I-85 would have been so much worse, and we would have had a whole different set of problems, you know, if people knew. But back then, really, a day was enough time to prepare. Now, the world is more complicated.
Mm-hmm.
There are more people, there's more wealth, there's just more things to do and worry about. So we try and give people a little more time than that, but by giving them more time, now there's more uncertainty.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a challenging balance to get people to take action when they need to be done when they have to be done, but not get too anxious too soon. I think the biggest lesson is that the worst does happen.
Mm.
You know, we tend to look at hurricanes and use our experience with hurricanes to say, oh, they always turn. It's never as bad as they say it's going to be. But Andrew proves that that's not always true.